Today, my topic for presentation is semiconductor material. You all are the well known about the electronics. Nowadays, electronic plays vital role in the field of science and technology. That is based on the semiconductor material and devices. When we are talking about semiconductor material, three things comes in our mind: that all electronic devices are made up of three types of the materials. One is the conductor material, insulator material, third one is the semiconductor material. You all know conductor material is that material that allow the flow of electrons, and insulator is that material that resists the current, that resists the flow of current. But today I am interested in the semiconductor material. So far that we all know that semiconductor material have the properties that it is not conductor neither insulator, but semiconductor material have the intermediary properties. That's why it has so importance in the field of electronics, in the field of the circuit designing, because nowadays networks and telecommunication also depend upon the electronic devices. All devices which supported to the communication, which are made up of the electronics. And nowadays we are living in the global village, and we are using the laptops, we are using the computers like supercomputers. If we talk about the transistor invention in the Bell Lab, the headquarter was the New Jersey, where it was introduced by the Breton Baden and William Shockley. Okay?
Yes, sir.
So for that, after the invention of the transistor, digital electronics takes place in the current era, and all digital equipment made us our lives easier. So for that, before discussing about these devices, before studying about these devices, we must know about the basic material which support these types of the communication and signaling system. Now, here we are proceeding forward. That today we will cover these topics. First of all, semiconductor material, why it is so important in this modern age, and how semiconductor we can make it insulator, and how we will make it as a conductor, and how p-n junction is formed, how depletion layer is formed, how biasing we are applying, how forward biasing and reverse biasing takes place, and what effect of the voltage and current characteristics on the p-n junction when we are forward biasing or reverse biasing. Basically, semiconductor material is the material which we have already talked that it has intermediary properties. It is nor conductor and neither insulator, but it has intermediary properties. Keep it remember, semiconductor material is that material we can made it as an insulator, we can make it as a conductor. So for that, we can say The semiconductor material has the great importance because we can easily control the flow of current, we can easily resist the flow of current, we can easily prevent the flow of current. So for that, semiconductor material have the great importance. We know that the semiconductor material basically available in the natural on the earth, naturally on the earth, in abundance quantity. Keep it remember, the major source of the oxygen in the natural environment. Secondly, silicon is available in abundance quantity. Keep it remember.
Yes, sir.
But you know that silicon, germanium, these are the examples of semiconductor material. And you know, sand dunes also the base source of the semiconductor material, from where we are getting silicon. And silicon, germanium, these are the basic material of the semiconductor components. When we are talking about these single elements, you know, as we know that conductor material like silver, like copper, like gold, like iron, same way, the insulator material is like rubber, like wood, these are the insulator material. When we are talking about silicon and germanium, these are the single element material which are used for the semiconductor devices. On the other hand, when we are talking about the compound elements, like compound semiconductor material such as gallium arsenide, gallium indium phosphide, as well as the gallium nitride and silicon carbide, these are the compound elements which are used for the semiconductor material. We know the characteristics of the semiconductor material, that the periodic table group 4 members, it meant elements, have the 4 electrons in their outermost shell. And it is the property of the semiconductor material, the element have 4 electrons in their outermost shell. And we know that conductor have only 1 electron in their outermost shell, like copper, like silver. You know, the suppose atomic number of the copper is 29, and it has only 1 electron in their outermost shell. But in case of semiconductor material, when we are talking about the silicon, germanium, these elements have 4 electrons in their outermost shell. And we know that silicon is a material which is mostly widely used in the semiconductor components. Here is the atomic structure of the semiconductor material silicon. You know that the atomic number of the silicon is 14, and you know how we can suppose place the electrons in each shell. We have formula through which we can easily place the electrons in each shell, 2n² and represent the number of shells. So for that, we know that if we are talking about first shell, it holds only 2 electrons. If we are talking about second shell, it can hold 8 electrons. But when we are talking about third shell, it can hold 18 maximum electrons. But in this case, silicon have only 14 atomic numbers. So for that, First shell have 2 electrons and second shell have 8 electrons. It will become 10 electrons. But the remaining 4 electrons we have placed in their outermost shell. And in element, the outermost shell known as the valence shell. And outermost electron is known as the valence electron. Keep it remember. And in spite of the valence electron, all atom part is known as the core of the atom. And always the valence electron take parts in the chemical reactions. So for that, why semiconductor material is so important, we have already discussed that we can make it as a conductor, we can make it as a insulator. So for that it has great importance in the field of electronics. When we are talking about how we can make the semiconductor material as an insulator, we have a process. Through covalent bonding, we can make the semiconductor material, pure semiconductor material, as a insulator. Keep it remember, when I am talking about the semiconductor material, it means I am talking about silicon, I am talking about germanium. When these same elements make the covalent bond with each other, it means silicon atoms make covalent bonding with each other, or germanium atoms make the covalent bonding with each other, or electrons link together to form the shared pair of electron. So this process make the what? No. Crystal. Crystal is the physical form of the suppose material. When these silicon atoms make the covalent bond with each other, what happens? Crystal lattice structure is formed. Okay? When crystal lattice structure is formed, that is also known as the physical structure. And in that condition, that material is known as the insulator. Keep it remember. So for that, if we see over here, these are the silicon atoms. This is also silicon, this is also silicon, this is also silicon, this is also silicon. These same material take part in the covalent bonding or sharing the electrons, yes, sir. Valence electrons.
Yes, sir.
Okay, in this case, what happened? This is the crystal formed, and we know that here you can see this is the crystal lattice structure. What? Crystal lattice structure. This is known as the physical structure. Got point?
Yes, sir.
Okay. When silicon make covalent bond like that way, that what happens? Crystal lattice structure form.
Yes, sir.
In this suppose state, the material is said to be insulator.
Yes, sir.
So keep it remember that semiconductor material, we can easily made it as a insulator when we make the covalent bonding. Got point?
Yes, sir.
When these links are linked, are these links are called what? Covalent bonds. So for that, in this state, semiconductor can be
insulator.
Called insulator.
Yes, sir.
Good insulating semiconductor material always referred as the intrinsic material. When I am talking about intrinsic and extrinsic, When pure intrinsic.
Yes, sir.
Semiconductor material make covalent bonding, then what happen? Insulator form.
Yes, sir.
But when pure semiconductor material, intrinsic semiconductor material added with the extrinsic semiconductor material, then what happen? Doping process takes place, or in this case we can say the material is known as the conductor material. Got point? But we are talking about the material, semiconductor material, how it will become the insulator. So for that we have learned, we have studied, when intrinsic semiconductor material make covalent bond with each other, links the or share the valence electron with each other, then what happen? Strong force of attraction takes place, and through this process crystal lattice structure is formed, physical structure is formed, and that is said to be insulator. Now we come to the point that how semiconductor material can be conductor. We all know that there is a process that is said to be doping process. Through doping process we can make the semiconductor material as a
conductor.
So for that we must know about the doping process. You all know that when we are adding impurities with pure semiconductor material, or we are adding intrinsic semiconductor material with extrinsic semiconductor material, the process is said to be doping. But when group 3 elements of the periodic table or group 5 elements of the periodic table will be added with the intrinsic semiconductor material, then what happens? Doping process takes place. Now we can say that when trivalent impurities added with the pure semiconductor material, what happens? Doping process takes place. We can say when pentavalent impurities added with the pure semiconductor material, what happens? Doping process takes place. Got point?
Yes, sir.
So for that, when pure semiconductor material doped with the extrinsic material, the new form material will be the conductor. We have two types of the impurities. One is the P-type impurities, and other is the N-type impurities. Keep it remember, when trivalent atoms and pentavalent atoms added with the pure semiconductor material, the new formed material become the extrinsic material. So for that, when pentavalent impurities added with the intrinsic semiconductor material, that electrons produce. Keep it remember, we know that silicon have the 4 electrons in their outermost shell. We can say these atoms are the tetravalent atoms. But on other hand, when we are talking about the pentavalent atoms, it means the pentavalent atoms have the 5 electrons in their outermost shell. So we know that 4 electrons of the 4 valence electron of the intrinsic semiconductor material like silicon participate with chemical reaction with the pentavalent atoms 4 electrons, but there is only 1 electron remaining. So for that we can say the electrons produce. One pentavalent atoms added, what happens? N-type material produce. N-type semiconductor material produce. But when you know that the pentavalent atoms like arsenic having the 33 atomic number, phosphorus having the 15 atomic number, when we are talking about the bismuth having the 83 atomic number, when we are talking about antimony that have the 51 atomic number, yes, and silicon have 14 electronic number, when we are talking about germanium it has 32 electronic atomic number. So for that, when these atoms take participate in the chemical reactions, it means make the covalent bonds with the intrinsic pure semiconductor material, what happens? N-type material produced. It means electrons produced. Got point?
Yes, sir.
But on other hand, when trivalent atoms added with the pure semiconductor material, what happens? P-type material produced. So for that, first of all we can look towards the whiteboard. Over here you can see this is the antimony and these are the silicon atoms. These are the intrinsic semiconductor materials and this is the extrinsic material. It means have the 5 electrons in their outermost shell. What happens? 1 electrons become free and jumps towards the conduction band. When the electrons are in the conduction band, due to the free movement of the electron, current can be produced. Got point?
Yes, sir.
So for that, we can say extra electron becomes the conduction electrons. Got point?
Yes, sir.
And these results, we know when pentavalent input is added, what happens? Majorities are the electron produced.
Yes,
but in the n-type material, the holes are in the minority.
Yes,
keep it remember. Electrons are in the majority in n-type material and holes are in minority. Got point?
Yes, sir.
So for that, because electrons has produced when pentavalent atoms participate in covalent bonding with the intrinsic semiconductor material. Now, how p-type material is formed? P-type semiconductor material is formed. So for that, keep it remember. We know the process that trivalent impurities when added with the pure semiconductor material, what happens? 4 electrons of the tetravalent atoms like intrinsic silicon atoms, okay, added with the trivalent atom, it means 3 electrons of the trivalent atoms, what happens? There is a hole remaining in the trivalent atoms. So for that we can say when trivalent impurity is added with the pure semiconductor material, what happens? P-type material produced. Now when P-type material is produced, then we can say the holes are in majority carrier. Holes are in majority and electrons are the minority. Got point?
Yes,
so for that we know that 2 regions are formed. One is the n-type region is formed and another is the p-type region is formed. And we know that n-type region have majority electrons and minority holes. And p-type material have majority holes and minority carrier electron. So for that, you know that these are the dissimilar charges.
Yes,
proton, it means p-type material and
n-type.
electrons, electrons and holes. These are the dissimilar charges. So far that these electrons wants to move towards the
holes.
But keep it remember, between these two regions there is border, there is link, that is known as the
junction.
Keep it remember. That's why one junction is available between the p-type material and the n-type material. Okay, this is the p-n junction basically. Why we are saying this is p-n junction? Because the border or link between the two regions, one is the electron region and another the hole region. So for that we can say this is the p-n junction. Okay, now let's look towards this figure. Here electrons are drifting here and there, because we know that in n-type material there is majority carrier of the electrons, and over here majority carriers are the holes. It means these are the spaces where, and these spaces can hold the electrons. This have the capability, and you know that these electrons wants to diffuse towards the
holes.
So for that depletion layer produce what? Depletion layer produce or barrier potential is produced. And we know that how depletion layer is produced, because the electrons wants to move towards the
holes.
Now what happens, keep it remember, if these electrons move towards here, what happen? There will be the holes produced. It means positive ion produced along the side of the junction. So for that, what happens when these move towards this p region, what happens? There electrons, it means negative charge is produced in the p type region. So there the barrier or the depletion layer produced. How? This is the what happens, which I am actually saying. When these electrons diffuse towards the p-type material, what happens in n-type region? Positive ions produce. It means holes produce. Electrons leave their spaces. What happens? Along the side of the junction, positive ions produce are created. And along the side of junction in p region, what happens? It means electrons increases. Then what we can say? Negative charges produce along the junction. So basically it will reverse the barrier potential. It create the barrier potential. It create the depletion region. Got point?
Yes,
so for that we can say after p-n junction how barrier potential is formed, how depletion layer is formed. And you know that p-n junction is simple, is that is known as the diode. What? Basically through p-n junction we can allow the flow of current or we can prevent the flow of current. It means by using semiconductor material we can be able to control flow of electrons. It means current can be easily allowed or prevented.
Yes,
got point?
Yes, sir.
So for that the two terms we can say biasing, forward biasing and reverse biasing, which we inshallah learn after few slides. Here we can say the barrier potential of the silicon diode is 0.7 volt. And the barrier potential of the germanium diode is 0.3 volt. Keep it remember. It means material will be active or it allow the flow of current when we are applying the external voltages 0.7 volt. If the material is silicon, if the material is germanium, it means we must apply 0.3 volts minimum. Then it perform its operation, its function. Got point?
Yes, sir.
So we have studied PN junction is simple is that is the diode. Because we have studied diode has two suppose terminals. One is anode and other is the cathode. Anode it have the positive charge and cathode have the negative charge. Got point?
Yes, sir.
Similar is that P region having the positive charges and N region have the
negative charges.
Got point?
Yes, sir.
So for that, now the material become as a conductor. Basically, we want to study how we made the semiconductor material as a conductor. So we have learned that we will be able to make the semiconductor material as a conductor when we apply the doping process.
Yes,
got point? When we added trivalent impurities and pentavalent impurities with intrinsic semiconductor material, what happens? P-type material is formed and N-type material is formed. Between these two type materials, there is one region, there is one border, there is one link that connect these two regions, p-type regions and
n-type
region, electrons and holes. So for that is known as the p-n junction, that is known as the basically junction, and that junction is available between two regions, we can say p-n junction. Got point? So for that, after that, you know how barrier potential is formed, how depletion layer is formed. If the material is silicon, the maximum barrier potential produced 0.7 volt. If the material is germanium, then the maximum barrier potential produced 0.3 volt. Got point?
Yes, sir.
These are the energy diagrams. If we can say, as we have studied, that we can make the semiconductor material as a conductor as well as insulator, you all know that the energy gap between the semiconductor material and insulator material and conductor material, how it differ from each other. We know that the conductor material have the smaller energy gap. Basically, energy gap is the difference between the conduction band and valence band. Got point?
Yes, sir.
So we can say that if we know that the octet of the semiconductor material is completely filled, so far that we can say there is huge energy gap between the conduction band and between the valence band. Got point?
Yes, sir.
So for that, now we have learned the semiconductor material has the intermediary energy gap. We know that's why we make it insulator as well as the conductor. Here is the P regions, you know, here is the majority carrier of the electrons and here is the majority carrier of the holes in the valence band. So for that, it means there are two regions and that through these two regions PN junction is formed. And how depletion layer is formed, you know that when these electrons wants to move over here, what happened? There is smaller basically distance between the PN region electrons and the holes. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Now, you know that when the material become the conductor, p-n junction, it means we can throw, be able to allow the flow of current, or we can prevent the flow of current through p-n junction. So for that we have a process that is known as the biasing. It means if the material is silicon material or the material is germanium material. Now what happened? Biasing is a process. It means applying external DC voltages on the p-n junction is known as the biasing. When we are applying battery on the p-n junction, DC voltages on p-n junction, that process is known as the biasing. So for that we know that there are two types of the biasing. One is the forward biasing and other is the reverse biasing. Forward biasing allow the flow of current from p-n junction, and reverse biasing resist the flow of current, prevent the flow of current, do not allow the flow of current from the p-n junction. It means controlled flow of electron takes place by using the semiconductor material. That's why it has great importance. Got point? Now if we are talking about the forward biasing, that is the condition through which current can flow, and reverse biasing the condition through which current do not flow. Got point? Now when we are applying battery or external source voltages on the p-n junction, in that way the n-type region we will connect with the negative terminal of the battery, and p-type material of the p-n junction we will connect with the positive terminal of battery. What happens? You know that the barrier potential of silicon diode is 0.7 volt and barrier potential of germanium diode is 0.3 volt. Now what happens? The applied voltages are greater than the barrier potential. It means 0.7 or 0.3 volt. So for that the applied voltage generated electron from the negative terminal of the battery will push these n region electrons, and the barrier potential or the depletion layer becomes overcome, and what happened? Current can easily flow from the negative terminal to the positive terminal of the battery. Now this process is known as the forward biasing. It means controlled flow of electron from negative, from electrons towards the holes. Got point? Flow of electrons from the n region towards the p region. Got point?
Yes, sir.
Now what effect on the forward biasing? You know that the depletion layer or the barrier potential becomes the overcome. It means barrier potential decrease when we are applying the external voltages. In that way we will connect the positive terminal of battery with the p region of the p-n junction, and we will connect n terminal of the battery with the n type region. Got point? So for that the electron current produced like that way. In this process, you know, this is the what, when we have applied the external battery, external voltages, what happens? These electrons pushes the n-type region electrons, and this barrier will come decrease or will become overcome. So for that these electrons move towards the p-type material. Okay?
Yes,
so this process is known as the forward biasing. Here is the suppose depletion region, but after biasing you can see this depletion layer or barrier potential decrease and electron move towards the holes. Now reverse busing. Keep it remember, reverse busing is the process when we are applying external voltages or battery or DC voltages on PN junction. In that way, positive terminal we are connecting with the n-type region of the PN junction and negative terminal of the battery we are connecting with the p-type region. Now what happens? These are the dissimilar charges and these attracts with each other. Now what happens? Depletion layer become increased. It means barrier potential become increased. So for that there is no flow of current. Got point?
Yes, sir.
This process is known as the reverse busing. Got point?
Yes, sir.
This is the reverse busing. If you can see, because we have connected opposite terminal of the battery with the PN junction regions. So for that, these are the dissimilar terminals, dissimilar charges, and these are attracting with each other. N-type region electrons connected with the p-type terminal of battery. So for that, these attract with each other. And on other hand, the p-type of the PN junction material connected with the n-terminal of battery. So for that, these are so attract with each other, and resultantly depletion layer increase. What effect will be the voltage and current characteristics on the forward busing? So for that, as we are increasing the voltages, forward voltages, what happen? Forward current produce. Okay, and you know that the material is silicon material that have the 0.7 volt. Okay, so for that, when we are applying forward voltages, external voltages, when it reaches at the 0.7, what happens? The forward current produce. Same way, as forward voltages will get changes, as forward current produce more. Same way, the voltage current characteristic curve of the reverse busing, you know that when we are applying the battery in the reverse busing to the PN junction, what happens? The knee current produced when busing reverse voltage we have applied on the PN junction. And what happened? Reverse current in microamperes, in nanoamperes produced. Got point? It is low current. Same way, if we can look towards this diagram, you can see that what impact of the complete voltage current curve on the forward and reverse busing. Same way, this is the complete voltage and current characteristic curve which shows the forward busing and which shows the reverse busing. As forward voltage increase, forward current produce. As reverse voltage is applied, what happens? Reverse current produced. Same way, what effect on the voltage current characteristic curve when temperature change? Keep it remember, if the material is silicon material that is 0.7 volt and the material is the germanium material that have the barrier potential 0.3 volt.
Yes,
now what will be the impact if temperature will get changes? Keep it remember, if temperature raise, what happens? The barrier potential becomes decreased. So for that, this shows the impact of the temperature. 125 centigrade is the normal temperature. Suppose when we have added the temperature change, what happens? The barrier potential will become decreased in forward busing as well as in reverse busing. So for that, if you have any question, you may ask, please. Thank you so much.